Thanks, Sanjeev. That was a wonderful talk, and we certainly appreciate the insider information on what really goes behind taking a key decision. It's something very inspiring for us. Let me start with asking you something on the recent update we had on the India ranking in the world. This one, we have now moved to 100 in a very short, short span of time. How do you think this will help us in our growth or the future India which we are looking at?
Well, obviously there is a benefit to being better ranked. But I think rather than take these rankings all that seriously, because these are the ranking is getting the ranking was not the purpose. Making ease of business was the purpose. And although the shift was disruptive, we hope that now that we have moved many of these painful changes that we talked about, whether IBC, GST, or many other things, you know, Aadhaar and many of the other things that we have introduced, disruptive as they may have been, people have now been getting used to this new paradigm, and we are now optimizing them. So now that we are beginning to optimize them, hopefully now the banks will also slowly go back to lending again, and so on, so capital will begin to flow through. So now hopefully we will, the point is not getting this ranking, but the ease of doing business will allow a new kind of entrepreneur to appear, to take risks, some of them hopefully to become really big. So this is what we want to happen, and the idea here was, whether it's foreign investors or domestic investors, the idea is that we become a place to do business.
Yeah.
And so that is basically the idea, and hopefully the hard work of all these changes I talked about will begin to sort of bear fruit.
Yeah, certainly, because if a foreign investor is looking at India and he sees a better rating, that would obviously help in...
Yeah, but as I said, I'm not too fussed about the rating itself.
Yeah.
You know, the point is that getting a rating from an agency is not what our aim is. Our aim is ultimately to make business easier for the entrepreneur.
Entrepreneurs.
So the real thing that we will hope is that in a year or two, as this economy begins to gather pace, this actually leads to higher investment. That is the real kicker, not getting the rating
numbers per se. Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. So, you know, we were probably in 2014 the ninth largest economy, and today we have certainly gone to probably sixth or seventh position. But still, if you see the top three or four, we have a long gap to bridge. How do you see we'll be able to get there, or how long do you think we'll take to maybe probably go to number three or four?
See, the point of the matter is that even China got here by essentially growing at high rates, but sustaining high rates. So the most important thing in all of this is to get the benefit of compound interest rates.
Yeah.
People underestimate the power of compound interest rates. Mm-hmm. So essentially China grew at occasionally at 10%, but mostly at this in the 7% plus range. But it kept it going from the 80s, 90s, from the late 80s it started growing very fast, but really in the 90s, then in the 2000s and up to now. And the compound interest rate is what, so even our jump, all this rapid increase that we are happening is happening because of compound interest rates, compounding. So the most important thing is not to get too excited, but to hold the thing. 7% and little above 7% is more than good enough to get us very, very far. Question is, how long can we do it? And we should do it without getting too excited and losing our head and attempting to do it too fast, in fact. And there is, of course, the famous examples of Southeast Asia.
Yeah.
All these countries in the 90s were considered to be countries that, in fact, in those days were considered to be not China, but these countries were considered to be the tiger economies that were emerging. And then they suddenly tripped and fell. And most of them, Korea came back, but many of them, like Philippines and so on, never really recovered from that shock. So since this is about compounding, sustaining these high growth, even 7% is good enough. If we just keep sustaining it over a period of time, you can dramatically see quality of life and other things begin to improve.
So you talked about sustained growth. So like you also mentioned about certain policy changes which the government is brought about, which will bring in this sustained growth. How long do you think it will take for us to probably reach there? In the sense, do you see the like I also recollect that we also the finance ministry has also said that India is capable of having a double-digit growth on a sustained basis, but in reality we have been somewhere near 6 or 7%. What is that which is stopping us from going there?
So as with everything, if you want even higher growth rates, you have to be willing to accept even higher rates of reform. So the question is, do you want GST type reforms every year? Because remember, growth is a disruptive thing. China's rapid growth meant, you know, they did very, very disruptive things. Massive expansion in urban systems, even faster than what we are seeing ourselves.
Yeah.
Massive land acquisitions and all kinds of things that happen as a result, roughshod, all kinds of environmental issues. So as with everything, there are trade-offs that have to be made. So yes, we are capable of growing at double digits, but the question is, given our democratic and other institutional constraints, we may not be willing to do that. Secondly, when you begin to grow very, very fast, there are other things that begin to happen. You know, inflation will turn up.
Right.
There'll be massive dislocation of the banking system can blow up. So my own view is that while we may be able to occasionally hit very, very high growth rates, even double-digit growth rates, and certainly we may even be capable of doing it, the question is, rather than get too fessed up about having double-digit growth rates for 1 or 2 years, a much more important issue is, even if we manage to get something slightly over 7% on a sustained basis, the power of compounding is what will get us where we want to be. A year or two here or there doesn't matter. But very important that we don't suddenly lose our heads about this matter.
Yeah.
So, yeah, great. If naturally we get a few good years of growth at 10%, good. But if we focus only on 10% growth and begin to forget about all these stability factors, then what will happen is that there's likelihood the economy will overheat or our banking system or something will blow up. So let's remember that speed is like with anybody riding a cycle. There is a point at which you have control and balance. If you're going too slow, it's difficult to balance. But if you go too fast also, the likelihood you'll go fast for a little while and fall off. So there is a, right now, what we are doing at running at little over 7%, we're managing to do this with reasonably keeping, you know, inflation and other parameters in control. We are carrying out structural reforms. I would argue that just keeping this going is pretty good.
Going to the exports, you know, India is currently doing about 300 billion exports. But when you compare to other economies like China or even Germany or US, we are far, far behind. Maybe we are 10% of what China exports, or a little over 25% of what Germany would do or US would do, and maybe half of what Japan is doing. So we still have a lot of mile to catch up. What measures the government is taking to make sure that we have a more export-oriented economy?
So there are many things that need to be done. I mean, some of it was just getting our basic infrastructure in place. And that, as I said, is now coming in place. So if you went back and looked at debates of even a decade ago, it was, infrastructure, our ports are not good enough, our roads are not good enough. Those things we have begun to sort out.
Yeah.
Many places have gotten sorted out.
Yeah.
So this problem is done. We now begin to getting into new areas that we now need to get into. Remember, we will be doing this export boost that you're talking about in an environment where there'll be artificial intelligence, there will be robotics, etc. So we cannot blindly say that, you know, just because the other guys did a certain kind of product mix and moved up the value chain, we will necessarily be able to do it through that. So it is something in which we have to continuously evolve strategies. One is, of course, the passive stuff, ease of doing business, etc. infrastructure, etc. But there are areas where we have to think strategically. One of those areas, since we are a software and IT exporting country, we have to invest heavily and encourage investment, private particularly, into areas that grow in these areas, artificial intelligence. Of course, Bangalore is an ecosystem where all kinds of innovation is happening in this area. We need to think about Bangalore particularly as a major, major industrial export hub where all this happens. And that is why sorting out Bangalore is a very important thing, because you cannot have high quality human capital clustering in a place like Bangalore with the kind of civic amenities that right. Bangalore has.
Right.
Because if good quality civic amenities do not exist here, good quality human capital will not live here. If good quality human capital does not live here, the innovations will not happen.
Right.
So you may ask, what is the single one of the things that you need to do to be export competitive? Well, oddly enough, making Bangalore as a city work is a very important part of our export strategy.
Yeah.
Similarly, we need to begin thinking of our universities in a completely different way. Currently, we think of our universities as some place where you go for 4 years, 6 years, whatever, you go, you study and you come out. This is not how, in fact, innovative hubs happen to exist in many of the cutting edge parts of the world. Whether you take Stanford and its impact on Silicon Valley, or you think of Oxford and Cambridge in the UK, or the impact of MIT, Harvard, etc. These are all major areas of innovation. We don't tend to use our universities as areas of innovation. We think of them purely as a teaching institution, and they're also subjected and separated from the world of commerce.
Mm.
We've got to stop thinking about this in this way. New universities need to be built closer to the city and integrated with the city, and very closely linked with industry and commerce and government. Many places which do already have existing institutions need to reorient it to be able to use their, So today, Kanpur or Kharagpur may have IITs, but Kanpur the city or Kharagpur the city have nothing to do with the IITs there.
Mm.
Whereas if you go to Cambridge, whether in the UK or in the US, you will see Cambridge, US, near Boston, that entire ecosystem is all about the universities, the ecosystem of intellectual activity that happens there, the innovations that happen. That so we need to begin to think about our universities as engines of growth.
In fact, many cities run because of universities.
Yes, so we need to begin to think of our cities and within them the universities as a part of the ecosystem that leads to innovation and cutting edge technologies. China, for example, since you talked about it, has been successful in being able to do this. It's leveraged the Pearl River Delta using Hong Kong and Macau and Shenzhen and so on. That's one major area. Shanghai is another area, and the area around Beijing. And in fact, one important thing to remember is that when you look at China's development and growth, in fact, 90% of China's growth comes from just 19 cities.
Mm-hmm.
Just 19 cities account for China's economy. Okay, the rest of it just lives off those 19 cities. So the very important thing to understand about economic growth and competitiveness is that you don't have to make all of India competitive. You have to make some, maybe not 19, we can just start with a dozen economic clusters good enough and make those world class, and that is what drives the rest of the thing. So we need to begin thinking of economic clusters, whether it's industrial clusters, since we are a services export, services clusters, but we can creatively think of many things, maybe tourism clusters.
Yep.
So these are all things we need to begin to think. So it's not about even growth. Growth by its very nature is an uneven activity. And therefore we need to think about what those clusters are and invest cutting edge stuff there. This idea, again, I keep coming back, we've got to stop thinking about going farm, we'll then become factory, and then we'll move up the value chain. Growth is not a ladder. Growth is about leapfrogging to the frontier. Whatever is, how far can you go in the frontiers, this is what the game is. And this is the context in which you have to see, for example, the building of the bullet train. Everybody says, oh, we are a poor country, why do we need the bullet train? We need the bullet train because it is the cutting edge, because we want to go to the frontier.
Yeah.
If you don't build the bullet train, don't bother, because the man on the street does not And this, incidentally, the funny thing is, the average Indian intuitively understands what I'm saying. So the old sort of bottom of the pyramid, we are poor, we must always use everything which is not quite cutting edge. This kind of thinking process led to the creating, the designing and building of the nano car. Right? Remember the nano car? Remember it was a disaster? Top. Because even the poorest people in the country do not want something that is not at the frontier. He would much rather drive the cutting edge motorcycle than drive a non-cutting edge car. If he can afford it, he will move on to the smartphone. So the point is, Indians, because we are at this point in history, we are aspirational, the average Indian wants to compete, you have to allow him to compete at the best.
So taking some points from what you said, we also had seen that the government had identified the smart city projects, but not much has been able to, you know, grow in that fast pace as what was initially perceived.
So I think you have misunderstood what the smart city project was about. See, the what we were trying to do was something somewhat different. See, the old way of doing, first of all, till about the 90s, nobody thought cities had to be invested in. The thinking generally was that India is a, India lives in it. Remember the Gandhi said, India lives in its villages? Mm-hmm. And therefore, cities were seen as sort of peripheral things that we had to somehow accept because, you know, because the government and industry insisted on living in cities, so we had to do it. But the real India lived in villages, and that's where it's all about. We thankfully changed that view around about 2000 onwards. We began to change that mindset that no, we had to invest in our cities. And the first round of investing in our cities basically was through something called JNURM. And the JNURM was basically a very infrastructure-led idea. So basically, oh, we need to make more pipes in for supplying water. So from the government, central government will get so much money. So pipes were laid out. Or you will think that we need to have better roads or buses or whatever. So central government will give you buses. Now this is a peculiar old style thinking, pretty much not very different from the way we used to think about, you know, it's a Soviet kind of thinking about how to improve cities. The point about the smart city was, and why it was a radical change, was that we said, no, what we really want is to upgrade a certain area or a certain infrastructure or a certain intervention that has city-wide effects. So if you look at the smart city, what were done? For example, several cities were given central control rooms for their public transport. Why? Because this now allows you to integrate multimodal transport. Earlier on, there was no link between your bus system and your metro system. There's no link between those two and your taxi system. Now you're creating a centralized model which integrates all your different
mobility.
Public mobility. Similarly, there are some more projects that are being done. I can't remember there are several others where basically a neighborhood is taken. Rather than improve the one thing across the city, you try and improve everything in one place. So one Varanasi, for example, we've just taken it and taken all the wiring that was hanging above and put it and piping and put it underground. Okay, so certain areas of Varanasi now don't have any of those old wires. So this is how it's being done. You take an area, clean it up, upgrade it, remove. So these are things that are fundamental things that had to be done. And each one of them is done to the requirements of that city. So that's the other thing that was achieved, is rather than have a top-down Delhi telling everybody else what to do, you then tell, you decide as a city what you need, and we'll give you the finances. So this is an experiment in, one, decentralization. It is an experiment in creating urban ecosystems rather than, you know, one grand thing from the top
central
that comes down. So there are many experiments that are going on. Not all of them will succeed. That is also fine. Yeah. But as a result of this process, we have, as I said, Indore with Swachh Bharat has worked.
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe it hasn't worked in other cities. Yeah. That's okay. But we now know what works.
Yeah. The learning is a key there.
Yeah.
Going to the oil prices, we've seen a huge surge in the oil prices in the past few months, or maybe from February, it's gone about by 40%. How do you think this will impact our economy and the growth which we are looking at?
See, we are an oil importer. High oil prices is a bad thing. Yeah. Okay, there is no other way to think about oil prices. We as a country are not endowed with oil.
Yep.
We are a fast growing economy which needs energy. If we are importing it and its price goes up, it's a bad thing. Now, no amount of introducing, messing around with GST, doing all this is going to change that. All the GST, if you do put this thing in GST, it will equalize the price across the country,
right.
But it's not going to do anything about the level.
Right.
So I'm afraid, you know, this is something we as a country have to take it on the chin. It's painful. Now, of course, if it goes beyond a certain level, there'll be political pressures and even economic pressures to cut back. But be aware that every time we cut taxes, we are cutting something else somewhere else.
Right.
This is not a choice we like to make, but we may have to make it. But it is not a free lunch. So as long as we are an importer of energy from the rest of the world, and if energy prices go up, somebody in our system will have to pay. The consumer may pay, the taxpayer may pay, somebody will have to pay. There is no easy way out of this.
But will it affect the growth which we are looking at? Or?
Well, at this level, it affects it a little bit. But if it goes significantly above from here, it will become much more painful. Yes.
I know government is trying to look for alternative means by encouraging.
We are discussing various alternatives are being explored internationally, Iran and so on. But internally, there's nothing we can do much about it in the short run. In the very long run, we can move to non-conventional energy, electricity, and other things.
Right.
In the short run, nothing we can do about it.
Even Iran, I think we have this U.S. sanction, which is
That's the source of the problem.
But
you know, it's not something in which we have yet clarity. So,
can you share your views on the infrastructure spending? I know you spoke about some things, both from a public government focus and also from a private sector point of view. Where do you think?
So, a lot of heavy infrastructure is getting rolled out. And in fact, as I mentioned, there are many areas in which now we have actually decent infrastructure.
Yeah.
Our highway network is not bad. And in the next 4 or 5 years, our network will basically be pretty good by any standards in the world. And some bits of it are already good by any standards. Our infrastructure in terms of airport connectivity is also not bad.
Yeah.
It's growing very, very rapidly. We have and many places, in fact, aviation is growing so fast that you know, many of our major airports are already at capacity to an extent that, say, for example, in Mumbai, we are functioning well above capacity of that airport, and a new brand new airport has already started construction. I believe we will be able to fly from those airports within 24 months. I believe even by the beginning of next year, the runway will be done, but the terminal will take a little more time. But Mumbai, within 24 months, will have a brand new airport. Delhi will have a new airport on the other side, on the Noida side, which is already, I believe, the land is earmarked, so new airports there. So in many places, civil aviation is getting sorted out. As I keep mentioning, we now know how to build certain kinds of intercity connectivity infrastructure. The real crux of the problem is now building intra-city infrastructure. Mm. And even there are some things which we are doing reasonably well. I'll give you one example. Delhi did not have a metro till 12 years ago. This year alone, we will open out 100 new kilometers of metro lines. So within the next year or so, Delhi will be the fourth largest metro network in the world after Shanghai, China, and Shanghai, Beijing, and London. So this is not bad for a city that didn't have a metro system 12 years ago. And it has fundamentally changed the way you think about Delhi, the way people move around.
Yeah.
This city has, of course, lagged in that, but I believe plans are there for building a new metro. But the point I'm making is, I gave you the example of cleaning up in Indore and conservation in Amritsar, or there are many such certain examples that we are building. But yes, this is going to be our next big challenge. What do we do with our intra-city infrastructure? We know how to do bits and pieces of it, but overall we don't know how to do it. Mm. But many experiments are on the way, and this is going to be the real big thing that we need to initiate. But just as we have shown with the intercity infrastructure, that we, when we put our minds to it, can do it. It is other countries have done it, we can also do it. So the same thing, I am quite confident, if we put our mind to it, we'll be able to do with our intra-city infrastructure as well.
You talked about the IBC, the way it was conceived and how it came in. Do you see that because of this, there would be some sort of easing on the NPAs which is happening?
Yes, at two levels. The first and obvious, the first order impact is that as many of these cases are getting resolved and auctioned, most of these assets, by the way, have already been marked down to zero. So any money you get back is back into the bank's balance sheet. Many of these, we are getting good valuations. We just give you one single example where we got 40,000 crores, 35,000 in cash, plus 5,000 more in equity. The banks have got one case 40,000 crores back. There was another one which was somewhat small, electro steel, I think 5,000-6,000 came back in that. Yeah. There are a few very large cases that should get done in the next 6 weeks. You will see serious chunks of money will come back. But that is the first order impact. I right at the beginning told you one of the most important things that was being attempted was to change the culture. And that culture has got fundamentally changed once and for all, painful as it may have been. And in fact, just some examples of it, 88,000 crores worth of money has been paid back by many promoters and companies that had defaulted earlier and were not paying earlier but have now suddenly come back and paid back. So quite apart from the NCLT IBC process, the change in culture has meant that another 88,000 has come back. Mm-hmm. So once you've changed the culture, it also means that the kinds of lending that was done will change. And the very fact that we've opened up the books and begun to go through them, that has changed the whole culture. It's just, the Nirav Modi case being one case. The whole system was festering with these things. We have opened up and found many of these cases. There were small, all kinds of things going on. Same thing is being done with Malia in this whole culture that you can do whatever you want. First of all, they never believed that anything would be done to them. Mm. Then they discovered, okay, if you stay in the country, something bad will happen, so you went abroad. Now you go and hunt them down abroad, and the net result of that is that you have changed the context. And I keep coming back to this. The overall context in which business and the culture in which business was being done had to be fundamentally changed. And we have indeed genuinely achieved that.
So you also mentioned about this public sector bank and all that. Do we see some more consolidation happening there?
See, we 22 public sector banks may be too many. But let me be very clear. This business of consolidation and mergers is a second order solution. As long as these are poor quality banks, merging two poor quality banks gives you a slightly larger poor quality bank. This does not solve the problem. So right now, so many, I think some 11 odd banks are under the RBI's direct PCA basis. Merging them is not going to solve any problem. When and as these are done, they will be done on commercial basis based on some reason why bank A plus bank B leads to some commercially profitable activity. But to think that you're taking these banks and simply merging them somehow solves the problem is not the case. It's certainly not the case that you take a bad quality bank and add it to a good quality bank that you'll get a better, larger, good quality bank. That's not the case. You're quite, just like with an infection, it's quite capable that the bad quality bank will infect the good quality bank and then you'll end up with a large, poor quality bank. So, the government understands this and we are not rushing to begin merging all these guys. We have to nurse them back to some health. And that is getting done slowly. At the very least, the deterioration of these banks has stopped. We now know what is the extent of the damage. And as time goes by, they are being nursed back.
We have seen that GST collections have recently been the highest, and we also heard the whole story of how it was tried and it's now getting settled. But if you look at the overall tax collection versus the expenditure, we still have a huge deficit which we need to manage. How do you think we'll be able to contain them?
See, obviously we're a deficit running country and we have. But if you look at the last 4 years, we have by and large remained well on track. Certainly the old days of uncontrolled deficits have gone. We now run deficits which are well within control. In fact, the debt to GDP ratio of the country is stable. In fact, it's fallen a little bit in recent years. This is not an area where we are about to sort of let go. So if when you know there are areas where we will spend a bit more. Recently, an MSB hikes have been announced, but they are well within what is affordable by the country.
The government also had announced some mudra schemes where they gave about 4-5 lakh crores to, I think, few crores of 10 crore people. How do you think this will support or go about helping the MSME sector?
So the idea here was to extend credit to new groups of entrepreneurs, people. The idea is to allow new kinds of enterprise, etc., to pop up. Because what was happening is that we found that as we were cleaning up the banks, most of the problem had been caused by the large loans. Yeah. But when you squeezed it, the smaller guys also got squeezed, and it was not fair. So a special effort was made to make sure that at the bottom of the system, credit still kept flowing. So that was what was being done. But in the end, we have to get the banks to be nursed back and to do full-scale normal lending, and the economy to be growing, in a conventional way.
We have recently seen a lot of trade wars, like U.S. Putting some duties on China and China retaliating. Same thing happening with India. How do you see in a long term or a medium term?
Obviously, global trade environment which is unstable, with protectionism popping up, and where there is uncertainty, obviously messes things up. Nevertheless, not everything is bad. If we are strategic about it, there are areas where we may be able to take advantage of this situation, because there are certain trading patterns that were there. And I think people are beginning to realize that those old set patterns are being disruptive. As these are disrupted, opportunities will also emerge. So although in the short run this is very confusing, and particularly in the case of Iran with these imposition of sanctions, it hurts us because we are an oil importer. But if you take a longer term view of the matter, it does mean, for example, the global supply chains will begin to diversify where they source from, because they can't have all their sourcing come from one country like China. So if we are clever and nimble about it, we should be able to take advantage of some of these opportunities.
I have some interesting question. Can you give us some insights on demonetization, its success or failure? And we've seen that the cash is again coming back to the economy. The amount of currency which is in circulation is probably at the highest level. So how do you look at it? Because
demonetization was an attempt to shake up the system and has to be seen in the wider context to many other things that were done about black money. So if you just see it in itself, it doesn't give the full picture. There's a whole bunch of things that were done, which includes everything from RERA to the Benami Properties Act to bringing this new act on bringing back foreign, what happens to fugitives who go abroad. So there is a whole gamut of things that were done. So this is only one step in that. It basically was the first step to try and shake that whole edifice of black money. So we have to see it in the wider context. And definitely, we generated enormous amounts of data. Now that we have a GST in place, we actually have a fair idea of how this cash flows. And by the way, not all cash is bad, right? But we have now created, we now one know where all the cash is and how it flows thanks to GST. We, even though cash is coming back, remember, one important thing is that digital payments are also growing at even faster pace. Yeah. In fact, those of you who may not be aware, that UPI and RuPay cards are explosively growing. So generally there is circulation of money that is growing, and while yes, a lot of it is going into cash, the fact is the electronic payment is growing much, much faster. Yeah. So we have a fairly good idea of where all this money is circulating, and it is much, much tougher than it used to be to evade taxes than it.
A small request. You can end the session with two more questions as we are running out of time.
Thank you. Okay. So, We have seen that Federal Reserve is raising the rates, and we have the inflation, and our currency is also getting there is a lot of pressure on the currency. So how do you see the do you look that the currency would further fall or would it stabilize?
I think first of all, of course, this is an area which is Reserve Bank's area of authority. Nevertheless, let me clarify a few things. First of all, the rupee is not collapsing. It's it spiked to 68 back in 2013. It's now spiked to 69, and no catastrophic thing has happened to us. Number one. So let's keep that in context. Only in the beginning of this year, it was at somewhere around 64, and everybody was complaining that it was too strong.
Yeah.
So if you live in a world of flexible exchange rates, you have to allow for the exchange rate to be flexible. All that you will do is that we have foreign exchange reserves to stop it from big spikes in either direction, and we have adequate foreign exchange reserves to stop that happening. Now, having made this point, let me again give you through a little bit of an economics class. Anybody who studied economics here will know something about what is called the impossible trinity, which is that if you happen to have open capital accounts, which we have more or less open, we do have some capital controls, but more or less it's open, then you have to choose between one or the other, which is either your monetary policy or your exchange rate. You cannot control both your monetary policy and your exchange rate simultaneously once you have open capital accounts. Now, when we created a monetary policy committee with an explicit exchange interest rate, inflation target, then what we effectively did, we opted for monetary policy, which, by the way, is possibly the correct thing to do for a large country like us. So once we have accepted monetary policy as being the primary, then the exchange rate is something we basically have to accept.
Yep.
So there's no point in saying what is the exchange rate you're targeting. We are not targeting the exchange rate at all. We are targeting monetary policy.
Yeah.
The exchange rate is simply an outcome of this monetary policy and what is happening in the rest of the world. All that the central bank will do, and it has more than adequate reserves to do, is to smoothen out the spikes. So we will smoothen out the curve. There's a sudden shock. Reserves will be used, and we have more than adequate reserves to smoothen the path. But what will not happen is to target a particular exchange rate. We can't do it because we have explicitly opted for monetary policy.
Okay, Sanjeev, so my last question, what are the measures which the government is taking to create additional jobs?
So first of all, there's this long debate on jobs that is going on. The fact of the matter is that we genuinely, and this is sad, but it is true, we have very poor data on this whole thing. But nevertheless, there is the evidence that is there, and one can dispute whether it's good evidence or bad evidence, but to the extent that there is, which is the EPFO data, suggests that jobs are being created.
Yeah.
Where are they being created? Well, there are certain sectors which are clearly growing. There are certainly anything related to consumers. Anybody who is related to it can see that there's a boom in consumer activity. Tourism is going through a massive expansion. So yet again, it is the services sector that is expanding very, very quickly and generating the jobs. It is not, as many people would have preferred perhaps, it has not been the manufacturing sector. So I would argue that the manufacturing sector is still not pulling its weight, but the services sector is genuinely generating jobs. We don't know exactly how much, and that is a serious data problem and a lacuna, but what we can observe is not maybe the amount of jobs being created, but we can observe the wages. That we can. So the question is, are wages rising or not? Because if we are not generating enough jobs to absorb the workforce, then wages would stagnate or fall. And for most sectors in the country, with one exception, oddly enough, since I'm here, in IT sector it is not going up, but in many other sectors in the country, the wages are going up. And this includes, incidentally, farm wages. Farm wages one of the complaints that farmers very often have is that farm labor has become radically more expensive. But you are seeing that in many, many other areas where there is actually many, many specialized areas in the country, there are shortages of good workers. By the way, one of them happens to be economists.